Oh, my name's Kathy Friedman, and I am an associate professor in the Biological Sciences Department at Vanderbilt, and I teach primarily genetics, an introductory genetics course, and also an advanced genetics course.
And my name is Jennifer Osterhage. I'm a lecturer at the University of Kentucky in the biology department, and I teach introductory biology and a genetics course, and also coordinate the genetics labs at the university.
So genetics is one of our intermediate level courses, so it follows after a year of general biology in which students get a little introduction to genetics, but not in depth, and it's a one semester course. And we cover both aspects of Mendelian genetics and also what you might think of as more traditional genetics, and also quite a bit of molecular genetics in the class as well. There are anywhere between 30 and 100 students in the class, depending on the semester. A lot of them are biology majors. We actually have three different types of biology majors at Vanderbilt, and all three of those majors require genetics as one of the classes. So all of our majors come through the course, but we also get quite a few students who are, it's often not required for medical school, but they might feel that it's important to take it for medical school admissions, or who are coming from biomedical engineering, for example, and want to have some genetics.
I was a teaching assistant for the course that Kathy taught, and was also working on a teaching certificate through the Center for Teaching and incorporating some projects, a project into the course. Interested in whether we could use concept maps to identify student knowledge structures. So I went into the course as an exam review and asked students, we had nodes on post-it notes, and asked students first to arrange the nodes, arrange the concepts from what they thought was the most important at the top down to more trivial kind of concepts, and then make connections, concise connections between those concepts. And then I looked at the maps and analyzed them for lots of different variables, so number of connections, accuracy of connections, but discovered something really interesting that I think we weren't expecting, and that you could discover something about their knowledge structure by the type of language that they used in those connections. So was it absolute type language, or did they understand the conditions when a connection would be true?
Yeah, so it was an extremely interesting exercise. I was predicting that we would see differences in how the students arranged those mm-hmm. post-it notes, or maybe how many connections they made. And I think Jennifer really didn't find any major differences there. But as she said, discovered instead it was really in how they made the connections, or what they wrote along the line between the connections. So just to give you an example, two of the nodes that Jennifer gave them on the post-it notes, one was a technique that we use in molecular biology, and the other was something that can be detected in some cases, but not in all cases, by that technique. Okay, so it was mutation in this case. And the students who used the more concrete or absolute language would draw a line between these. They understood they were connected, but then they would say the technique mm-hmm. shows mutation. Whereas the students who had made clearly a leap, they were able to contextualize this mm-hmm. better along the node, would write something about this technique can sometimes indicate mutation mm-hmm. because they understood that you couldn't detect every type of mutation using that technique. And when Jennifer scored the concept maps just really in just two bins as mm-hmm. being, you know, more concrete or more nuanced, and then compared that with the scores that the students got on the test, there was mm-hmm. a very clear difference that the mm-hmm. students who were able to make those more nuanced connections had done better on the exam. And so I think that really resonated with me, because genetics is considered a hard course at every single university. I asked my mm-hmm. colleagues about this, and they all say, oh, you know, genetics always gets a bad rap everywhere. Mm-hmm. And it's because students come into genetics thinking biology is all about memorization, mm-hmm. and that if I memorize all these words and I know the definitions, that I'm going to do really well on the exam. And genetics is very much about concepts and applying concepts. And so students will come into class, and let's take that method as an example again. They'll say, I want a list of when I should use this method. Mm-hmm. I want a list. Give me a list, because they can memorize the list and they feel like they can then spit that back on the test. And what the concept map, I think, made very clear is that the students who need the list are the ones who are still have these very concrete connections. And what I want to try to do with students is get them to the point where they understand the technique well enough and how it works and why it works, that they don't need the list, because you can figure out the context in which it will work if you really understand the technique itself. And I think that's exactly what we were seeing in those concept maps. So I mentioned earlier that the students like to be given lists in class for how to memorize things. And this really isn't the best way for them to approach things in the class. I really want them to approach the class in terms of thinking about concepts and identifying concepts and how they fit together. And that's because what we're really trying to teach in genetics is a way of thinking. It's being able to take information that you may get from an experiment, and being able to understand what that information means, having considered the things that you've learned about. So it certainly doesn't mean that you don't have to learn facts. There are facts you need to learn. But what I try to tell them is that there are certain basic things that if you really understand how they work, then you can figure the other things out. So here's an example. So a lot of people learn Mendelian genetics by memorizing ratios. It's a 3-to-1 ratio. It's a 9-to-3-to-3-to-1 ratio. And because it's a lot of numbers, 6 months later, you're going to have forgotten it, right? But if you know how meiosis works, if you really understand how the chromosomes move during meiosis, then Mendel becomes completely self-evident. It falls directly out of what the chromosomes are doing. And we have this huge advantage that Mendel didn't have, that we understand meiosis now. Mendel had never seen meiosis, so his genius was that he figured that all out on a purely mathematical basis. But we can understand it from coming from meiosis, and my hope is then that becomes an understanding that they take forward, and they can always figure it out later, long after they've forgotten 9-to-3-to-3-to-1.
And that's the type of thinking we expected on the exam, the contextualize, you know, being able to apply their knowledge to new questions. And I think we realized that was lacking at the beginning, their ability to, for some students, not all students, their ability to take their list of facts and apply it to new problems was a challenge. And I think that's partly what makes genetics such a challenge for a lot of students.
It's not uncommon that I'll have a student tell me, you know, this is the worst grade I've ever gotten, or this is the hardest class I've ever taken. And if you explore a little bit, those are students who will admit that they're extremely good memorizers. And they have managed to just sail through other courses up until that point by simply memorizing. And they're hitting then a point in their development, right, as a scholar, where it isn't about memorizing anymore. And some of them, it takes a while for them to kind of get their head around that. For me as a student, math was an area where I was a memorizer. But I can understand where they're coming from, because that was me in math. And I had to work very hard in math to get where I could do anything other than memorize how to do a problem and just repeat it. And I could get there with a lot of practice. I spent hours in our math skills center in college. But that took a lot of extra work for me. And so that's something I try to tell students, is that, you know, everybody has areas where they might need to work harder to develop skills. I think it does help to help them have a little introspection about how they learn and how they think about things.
And when I have students in my office and I ask them how they study, and if they say, oh, I make note cards, I say, okay, well, don't break up that information that should be a big picture. If you've got to make note cards, put them on the floor, arrange them, group them together, you know, what goes with what. And, you know, the note card strategy is hard for them to break, I think. But in courses like genetics, I don't think it's very helpful to break up all these words into, you know, separate entities, when really you should think about them as, you know, how are they working together? How are they connected?